So let's start with Margot Cotton, Ballad of a Thin Man.
You walk into the room with a pencil in your hand. You see somebody naked and you said, "Who's that man?" You try so hard to understand just what you will say when you get home, because something is happening and you don't know what it is. Do you, Mr. Jones? You raise up your head and you ask, "Is this where it is?" And somebody points to you and says, "It's his." And you say, "What's mine?" And somebody else says, "Well, what is?" And you say, "Oh my God, am I here all alone?" But something is happening and you don't know what it is. Do you, Mr. Jones? In your ticket and you go watch the geek, who immediately walks up to you when he hears you speak and says, "How does it feel to be such a freak?" And you say, "Impossible," as he hands you a bone. And something is happening here, but you don't know what it is. Do you, Mr. Jones? You have many contacts among the lumberjacks to get your facts when someone attacks your imagination, but nobody has any respect. Anyway, they already expect you to all give a check to tax-deductible charity organizations. You've been with the professors and they've all liked your looks. With great lawyers you have discussed leopards and crooks. You've been through all of F. Scott Fitzgerald's books. You're very well read, it's well known. Something is happening here and you don't know what it is. Do you, Mr. Jones? Well, the sword swallower, he comes up to you and then he kneels. He crosses himself and then he clicks his high heels. And without further notice he asks you how it feels, and it says, "Thanks for your throat, thanks for the loan." And you know something is happening here, but you don't know what it is. Do you, Mr. Jones? Now you see this one-eyed midget shouting the word "now," and you say, "For what reason?" And he says, "How?" And you say, "What does this mean?" And he screams back, "You're a cow. Give me some milk or else go home." And you know something is happening, but you don't know what it is. Do you, Mr. Jones? Well, you walk into the room like a camel and then you frown. You put your eyes in your pockets and your nose on the ground. There ought to be a law against you coming around, ears should be made to wear headphones. Cause something is happening and you don't know what it is. Do you, Mr. Jones?
Well, if you're just joining us, that was the Ballad of a Thin Man. It's included in the Highway 61 Revisited album, the same album of for Like a Rolling Stone. And just like a Rolling Stone, who the Thin Man is, who Mr. Jones is, remains a mystery. Mr. Jones, Brian Jones of the Rolling Stones, freaked out when he heard this song because he thought it was about him, but it wasn't. Anyways, that was Margot Cotton. She does several covers of Dylan. I really like her. And this one, she's just playing guitar, but I think we have included her in the prelude before, and she does play every instrument. She has her own recording studio in one track. I can't remember which one it was, but she played electric guitar, harmonica, drums, as well as singing. Anyways, the next one maybe is better known artist, Lucinda Williams, and she's doing Queen Jane Approximately, which is also from the Highway 61 Revisited album.
Sister, he explains.
Hey, that was Lucinda Williams singing Queen Jane approximately. The song also has a lot of speculation as to who Queen Jane really was. Again, we'll never know, but a lot of people think it was Joan Baez. Remember, Joan Baez was, there was a relationship between her and Bob Dylan. And well, Joan Baez thinks it's her as well. So, anyways, that's what's coming up in Highway 61 Revisited. The lyrics are amazing, as you'll see tonight when we cover one of Dylan's other songs on the album. It'll give you an idea how much how it's so packed with meaning. Anyways, last session we were doing Cohen, and we still have a few more Cohen sessions coming up. But we had some technical difficulties, and this song was, I promised I was going to cover in this prelude. We didn't get a chance to cover it last time because of the technical difficulties. Leonard Cohen is really beloved in Israel, and there are Israeli artists are playing his stuff, performing, covering his songs in English, in Hebrew. And this is just another example. The song is quite meaningful because it was written by Leonard Cohen and performed while he was in the Sinai performing for the Israeli troops in the 1973 Yom Kippur War. The lyrics changed, however. When he wrote the lyrics initially, it was about he was talking to the Israeli soldiers. It was right in the lyrics, and then it became more of a universal soldier song. So here it is, a cover by two Israelis, Maya Belsitzman and Yeva Alon, if I'm pronoun I hope I'm pronouncing it right. Lover, lover, lover.
I asked my father, I said, Father, change my name. The one I'm using now is covered up with fear and filth and cowardice and shame. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. He said, I locked you in this body. I meant it as a kind of trial. You can use it for a weapon or to make some women smile. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Then let me start again, I cried. Please let me start again. I want a face that's fair this time. I want a spirit that is calm. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Aside, he said, I never walked away. It was you who built the temple. It was you who covered up my face. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Yes, a lover, 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 come back to me. And may the spirit of this song may rise up pure and free. May it be a shield for you, a shield against the enemy. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Yes, and lover, 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 come back to me. Yes, and lover.
That was Lover, Lover, Lover. We covered that in the last session. It's a beautiful song. The lyrics are great and a very meaningful song, particularly for the time, the Yom Kippur War. If you missed it, I encourage you to go watch it. It's on available. It's recorded on the Besh. It's included on the Besh Shalom website under Watch Programs. And it's the very last one in the set of recorded programs I have, number 54 in December, the last one of the year 2023. I was going to play a nice adagio piece. It's very what I usually do in the last few months of this Hamas war, playing you music that I find relevant. It's sad. It's got lots of cellos and violin, that kind of sound. But we're going to postpone it this week because somebody sent me another one that some of you may have already seen and heard. It continues with the music theme of October 7th. Here's a concert that comes right from Israel with that theme. hard to speak after that, and it's hard to think about anything else, but we're going to try. So if you're just joining us, we're going to be continuing where we left off. I don't even remember how long ago that was. We were doing Like a Rolling Stone, a couple sessions. We're still in the same album, Highway 61 Revisit. In fact, we barely scratched the surface. And tonight, we're doing Tombstone Blues. Well, before we begin, I just want you to know that Alexa is here with us tonight, co-hosting, and she is taking over. It's not taking over. It's just Sanchi is not available tonight, and Alexa kindly is helping out tonight. She's a very busy lady, so I'm very thankful that she can take the time to help me out tonight. She's an educator at the shul, and she does amazing things. And one of the things you can participate in is her Holy History series every Wednesday night at 6:30. And she'll be around to talk about it after the session. I hope you're interested. She's really great. Anyways, back to Tombstone Blues. That's the second song on the Highway 61 Revisited album. And it conjures up images of the old Wild West. And at the same time, tombstones, of course, tombstones and death. Tombstone happens to be the historic city in Arizona, the symbol of the American conquest of the Wild West, and the site of the famous gunfight at the OK Corral in 1881. However, the song is not a historic retelling of this famous gunfight. Dylan instead assembles a dizzying array of political, cultural, literary references from different time periods, and he brings in real and fictional characters. He throws it all together in a few lines, and it's really a surreal ridicule of the establishment and possibly the peace movements too. Dylan may be saying, the more things change, the more they stay the same. We are, in effect, still in the old Wild West. The image of the historic gunfight at OK Corral may represent all times gone by and to come, including the gunfighting and the chaotic spirit of America in the 60s when this song was written. Nothing changes. If you were to go visit Tombstone, this is what it would look like. It's still, I guess, pretty touristy. And it's, of course, the site where the famous gunfight was. There's no clear narrative to the song, as I said. Dylan uses a standard blues melody with surreal writing style to convey his ideas. And that using surrealism has never been done before in pop music history, not before Highway 61, anyways. And from Wikipedia, surrealism is a cultural movement that developed in Europe in the aftermath of World War I, in which artists depicted unnerving, illogical scenes and developed techniques to allow the unconscious mind to express itself. Wikipedia continues, works of surrealism feature the elements of surprise and unexpected juxtapositions. So you can expect that in this song, Tombstone Blues. And several Dylan analysts call this a protest song. I beg to differ. Dylan made it emphatically clear when he left folk music that he was no longer following any authoritative leaders and movements. In Dylan's own words, he claimed that to be on the side of people who are struggling for something doesn't mean you are being political. The converse may also be true. One can be political, but choose not to write political songs. Another artist who was political but chose not to write political songs was Paul Simon. I can tell you that because I'm doing research on him right now, and I hope to have a whole series of Simon and Garfunkel and Paul Simon sessions starting next fall. Anyways, Paul Simon campaigned for presidential candidates and he railed against South African apartheid. So he was political, but he didn't express that protest in his own music. He didn't want to lessen the integrity of his artistic songs with cheap and ineffectual words of protest. Dylan felt the same way, and both believed protest song should not change, could not change anything anyways. Anyways, as I said, Dylan is not protesting in Tombstone Blues. He's simply painting a surreal picture of the way he sees things are in America. It's not a pretty picture of America, and it's scathing of irresponsible authority. Dylan claims inspiration for writing of this song when he went to a bar where police were discussing a repugnant murder cases or fraud. In his own words, he says, "I felt like I'd broken through with this song, that nothing like it had been done before. Just a flash, really. There was this one bar I used to play where cops would always come and hang out, mostly off duty. They'd always be talking stuff, saying like, I don't know who killed him or why, but I'm sure glad he's gone, that kind of stuff. You'd hear stuff like that all the time. I think I wrote this either in that place or remembering some conversations. This song reminds me of Desolation Row, which is the last song on the Highway 61 Revisited album. Both songs have familiar historical characters in the song narrative that appear unexpectedly, as I say, entering the wrong theater stage doors into the wrong scenes, thus jolting our unsettling and unsettling our senses. You don't expect these characters to appear the way they are in the song based on what we know about them. The world is described in an absurdist fashion as mixed up, chaotic, and deadly. Many Dylan analysts with good arguments believe the song is at least in part about the Vietnam War. On the other hand, there is no direct references to Vietnam. Whether that connection was intended, only Dylan would know for sure. Like many Dylan songs, it is purposely constructed with an open framework allowing for many interpretations that become relevant to us in the future and in different places. Like I said many times before, this writing style gives his songs a life of their own, as interpretations to the lyrics and how they play the song evolve over time and in different places. Let's dig a little deeper into the song lyrics and try to make some sense out of them. The first verse begins the rollicking ride through the song. Is it any wonder that Paul Revere's name is referenced in the first verse to let us know what kind of song this will be? In other words, a rollicking song, and he's creating an image from America's past. It's beginning, really. The rhyming scheme in his songs are in this song is quite simple. The last words in each of the first three lines of each verse rhyme. I'll show you when we go forward. The last word of each verse rhymes with the last word of the following verse. The chorus has its own rhyming scheme. So here's the first verse. The sweet pretty things are in the bed now, of course. The city fathers, they're trying to endorse the reincarnation of Paul Revere's horse, but the town has no need to be nervous. The politicians of the town are referred to as the city fathers. Remember, Dylan disdains anyone with authority. And maybe the pretty things in bed are the politicians' mistresses. Well, if you think about it, nothing has changed over time. The city fathers, they're trying, this is the line, the city fathers are trying to endorse the reincarnation of Paul Revere's horse. Well, Paul Revere was, of course, a national hero and a founding father of America. Paul Revere is best known for his midnight ride to warn the colonial militia that the British were coming. The battles at Lexington and Concord that would follow led to the American independence from Britain. The city fathers may be appealing to the townspeople's patriotism by making reference to Paul Revere and bringing forth their own plans and legislation. It's kind of like using sugar to put down and make it easier to take the medicine. That is their plans and legislation. Only thing, though, is they're not conjuring up Paul Revere. They're actually conjuring up the horse he rode in the epic Midnight Ride. Either the politicians are dumb, or Dylan needed a word to rhyme with horse, or maybe both. Remember, the lyrics are surreal, but the last line in the first verse makes it pretty clear about the message Dylan wants to deliver. When he says, "But the town has no need to be nervous," he, of course, is being cynical. Of course, the townspeople need to be wary of what the politician plans and legislation will bring. Some things never change. The next verse. Again, notice in red the rhyming words. "The ghost of Belle Star, she hands down her wits to Jezebel, the nun, she violently knits a bald wig for Jack the Ripper, who sits at the head of the Chamber of Commerce." If Dylan hates and mocks people with authority, like the city fathers and politicians, he loves independent-minded outliers, like outlaws, who do not submit to authority. Belle Star was an outlier. She only lived 41 years. Her name was Myra Maybell Shirley Reed Starr. She comes from the old Wild West, and it was at least involved with horse theft, as much as we know, probably more. She would have been associated with all kinds of outlaws during her lifetime. As I said, she was only 41 when she was murdered in an unsolved crime. How does Belle Starr give her wits to Jezebel, who comes from a much earlier time, biblical time? It's a good example of surrealism. Remember, this is a song about absurdist lyrics painting a picture about human beings existing in a purposeless, chaotic universe. Jezebel, surprisingly, is described as Jezebel the nun. Another good example of surrealism. We know anything about Jezebel in the Bible. She was definitely not a nun. And he's deliberately jarring our senses because he knows we understand Jezebel differently. Jezebel, according to folklore and the biblical Book of Kings, was no saint. In the biblical narrative, Jezebel, along with her husband Ahab, king of northern Israel, instituted the worship of idols on a national scale. Jezebel also clashed with biblical prophets of the time. In Christian lore, Jezebel was a pagan or an apostate, masquerading as a servant of God, in other words, a false prophet. Jezebel, over time, came to be associated with false prophets, and these associations we have with Jezebel would clash with the false label of a nun given to her in the song lyrics. Christians also associated Jezebel with promiscuity. It is Jezebel, really disguised as a nun who knits, violently no less, a disguise for none other than Jack the Ripper, so he can sit himself disguised at the head of the Chamber of Commerce. Guess what he's going to do there? Of course, Jack the Ripper is well known for being a serial murderer of prostitutes in London towards the end of the 19th century. You see the irony here? Jezebel, a prostitute, helps a serial prostitute killer. Dylan overhears cops talking in a pub. This gave him the sparkling inspiration to write this song. The cop said, "The guy should have stuck to ripping off his own people." Cop ripping off the people may have led Dylan to associate this action with the notorious Jack called the Ripper. Jack the Ripper, a murderer also ripped off from another time, is now in a position of power and leadership to continuing ripping off helpless lower class prostitutes and other working class people in the town as the head of the Chamber of Commerce. So he's still doing his thing. He's ripping off people still. Jack the Ripper lives on forever in spirit, ripping off people in Dylan's song. The chorus, which is repeated after every two verses, is, "Mama's in the factory, she ain't got no shoes. Daddy's in the alley, he's looking for the food. I'm in the streets with the tombstone blues. Mama works in a factory, she ain't got no shoes," suggests she's a working class poor lady. Looking for the foos? Maybe foos is the closest word to food. If you listen to the song, it actually sounds like he's saying food. And so maybe dad's looking for food too. Or maybe the word fuse can be associated with a bomb. It could be that daddy may not be up to any good if he's in the alley, in a dark alley, let's presume, and not working as Mama is doing. The song narrator is in the streets, watching all around, death in the air, and is feeling the blues. Let's skip over to verse 5 and 6. So here we bring John the Baptist. Well, John the Baptist, after torturing a thief, looks up at his hero, the commander in chief. Say, tell me, great hero, but please make it brief. Is there a hole for me to get sick in? The commander in chief answers him while chasing a fly, saying, death to all those who would whimper and cry. And dropping a barbell, he points to the sky, saying, the sun's not yellow, it's chicken. So let's try to make some sense out of those two verses. In the mixed-up scene, presumably in the 60s when Dylan wrote the song, John the Baptist is called up. Not in his time and place. Only this time he's not performing as we would expect him to. He's not doing a baptism to wash away the sins of the thief. He's torturing the thief. It's another unexpected juxtaposition. Instead of looking up at the hill at Jesus, along with two thieves on each side of him being crucified, John is instead looking up to his hero, the commander in chief, a false prophet, jarring our senses once again. John is being transported to the 60s. Dylan wrote this about the song. John may now be a soldier, but not a good Christian soldier. And he is following his orders, just like the Nazis did, torturing his Viet Cong prisoner. The commander in chief could very well be Lyndon B. Johnson, President of the United States at the time, overseeing the Vietnam War. Well, John the Baptist may be following orders. He is none too pleased, and he's asking for a hole to get sick in. The hole may be his own grave or simply a hiding place from it all. The commander in chief is chasing a fly, which is something small, and is therefore he's overreaching. He's killing a fly probably with an elephant gun. He is telling John, death to all those who would whimper and cry. I wouldn't want to be a reluctant and unhappy soldier like John the Baptist because the commander in chief is ordering him to go after all draft dodgers and war protesters. Kill them all. Johnson is doubling down, thumping his chest, flexing his muscles, pumping iron, and he points to the heaven where the real commander in chief resides. The sun he is pointing to is yellow, but he may be referring to the homophone son, S-O-N, or Jesus. The commander-in-chief could be mocking Jesus, saying he's yellow or chicken and too cowardly to come back down to earth. The seventh verse may be a continuation of verses 5 and 6. The king of Philistines, his soldiers to save, puts jawbones on their tombstones and flatters their graves. Puts the Pied Pipers in prison and fattens the slaves, then sends them out to the jungle. Makes me think of Vietnam when you hear the word jungle. Dylan in this verse is alluding to the book of Judges and Samson. Of course, the king of Philistines and the jawbones references makes us think about Samson. In the biblical story, that's Judges 15, 14, 17, Samson killed 1,000 Philistines with just the jawbone of a donkey. Jawbones in the song is a metaphor for weapons, which the Philistine king, or in the 60s, the commander-in-chief, uses to honor or flatter the dead soldiers at their gravesides. Who ever heard of empathizing with Philistine soldiers who were slaughtered by Samson? Dylan likens them to other soldiers killed in wars, including the Vietnam War, and they are only pawns in their games, as in his song. Furthermore, the word tombstones used in this verse gives extra kick to the song title, Tombstone Blues. The prevailing deaths from wars gives us the Tombstone Blues title. Who are the Pied Pipers that the king of the Philistines or the commander-in-chief is putting in jail? From the blog, Wally Fant's Things I Write, the author speculates that the Pied Pipers is a reference to the fairy tale, Pied Piper of Hamelin, who lured children with his magic flute to jump over the edge of a cliff. In the 60s, during the Vietnam War, the Pied Pipers may be luring American young youth eligible for draft to protest or dodge the war. The Pied Pipers are leaders too, and Dylan doesn't trust them either. Figuratively, they are ultimately leading the young men to their deaths, or at least dead ends. The Pied Pipers, with their protest marches, will not change a thing. As he said in an earlier song, don't follow leaders, watch your parking meters. The king of the Philistines, who in a different time is the commander in chief, also fattens the slaves and sends them out to the jungle. The slaves are the not so free Black Americans, who are descendants of slaves, that get fattened up or prepared only to be sacrificed in war and battle in the jungles of Vietnam. Todd Haynes, the co-writer and director of the 2007 film, I'm Not There, a film inspired by the life and music of Bob Dylan, certainly believes that the above-mentioned verses are a reference to the Vietnam War, and the commander-in-chief is none other than Lyndon B. Johnson. Two lines from Tombstone Blues spoken by the commander-in-chief in the movie, death to those who would whimper and cry, and the sun's not yellow, it's chicken, are spoken by a digitally manipulated voice of Lyndon B. Johnson in the film. And you'll see in this video, Richie Havens, if you remember him, singing in the center of the three in the film. So here it is, Tombstone Blues clip from I'm Not There.
It's lonesome roads we shall walk. Till I join the Unicos.
Don't you know it's 1959? We done unionized 20 years ago.
Records indicate that you've been away. You stopped writing.
I've been on too many streets to be doing the same thing over and over. Can I smoke in here?
You sound, for someone so widely known, a bit fatalistic.
I'm not fatalistic. Bank tellers are fatalistic. Clerks are fatalistic. I'm a farmer. Who ever heard of a fatalistic farmer?
The sweet pretty things are in bed now, of course. The city fathers, they're trying to endorse the reincarnation of Corvus whores. But the town has no need to be nervous.
The hysterical brat in the penny arcade, screaming she moans, I've just been made. Then sends out for the doctor who pulls down the shade. Says my advice is to not let the boys in. Where Mulroney and Beethoven once unwrapped their bedroom.
Two players now rehearse around the flagpole.
And the National Bank for a profit sells roadmaps for the soul.
To the old folks home in the college.
Mama's in the factory, she ain't got no shoes. Daddy's in the alley, he's looking for food. I'm in the kitchen with the Tombstone Blues. Hey, hey, yeah.
Woo! Oh!
Boy, boy, it looked like you found your freedom before you found your technique.
You notice they use the word food as opposed to fuse in the song cover. But if you go to the official Dylan site, it still has the word fuse. Although when you hear him sing it, it does sound like food. So go figure. We will, of course, never know for sure if Dylan was making veiled references to the American involvement in the Vietnam War, although I strongly believe he was. The protest movement in America did not really get underway until 1966. Remember, this song is written in 65. And LBJ did, however, escalate the America's involvement in the war. And by 1965 in August, there still were no Vietnam protest songs, although it was firing up. Perhaps Dylan was ahead of the game, or maybe not. This is irrelevant because Dylan's real lyrics are so open-minded, as I said before, and as time rolls forward, we can insert our own relevancies with our own interpretations. So let's believe it is about the Vietnam War. The eighth verse, Gypsy Davy with a blowtorch, he burns out their camps. Again, that gives you vivid images of Vietnam. With his faithful slave, Pedro, behind him, he tramps with a fantastic collection of stamps to win friends and influence his uncle. Gypsy Davy, also known as Gypsy Laddie, is a Scottish traditional folk ballad that is over 300 years old. Again, Dylan's playing with time, going back and forth. The ballad tells the tale of a gypsy who charms a married woman to run away with him. There are so many versions recorded of this traditional ballad on both sides of the Atlantic Ocean. On the other side of the Atlantic, there are versions by the Incredible String Bang and Steel Eye Span, both group folk rock groups that I really used to love growing up. Dylan would certainly be familiar with the many song variations of Gypsy Laddie. Dylan's hero, Woody Guthrie, also recorded a version of that ballad. Since then, Waylon Jennings, Muddy Waters, The White Stripes, and even Bob Dylan recorded versions of this song. So here's my version that I'd like to play for you, the Incredible String Band doing Black Jack Davy.
Blackjack David is named that day. I've been alone in the forest a long time. Time has come and when the lady I find, I will love her and own her. She's singing through the green, green trees. Find that lady, I will. Know that skin on man's black leather right on my face is hard coming in with. Hearts are warm with the song that I sing with charmer. Fair lady, I'm singing through the green, green trees. Yeah, well. A fair lady showed up that day from a fine, fine home in the morning. In the flush of dawn, come a sound to her ear, drifting and floating, singing through the green, green trees. Last night, slept on a fine feather bed, far, far from Blackjack David. But tonight you sleep on a cold, cold ground and love him and hold him and sing it to the green, green tree. Saddle me up my fine gray mare, cried the lord of the house next morning. Servants tell me my daughter's gone with Black Jack David, singing through the green bay trees. Don't you know that he rode all day and he rode all night, but never did find his daughter. Heard from afar, drift on the wind, two voices laughing, singing through the green bay trees.
A rollicking song. I freshened up a song that's 300 years old. Gypsy Davy in Tombstone Blues is also reincarnated into the 60s, or he's another well-known figure who has opened the wrong theater stage door and into the wrong scene. Gypsy Davy opens the verse blow-torching villages as American soldiers did in Vietnam. His faithful slave Pedro behind him tramps may represent minorities who are compelled to join the war under the leadership of reckless, bloodthirsty soldiers and leaders. This manifestation of Gypsy David enjoys this war tour as if it were an exotic adventure and an opportunity to collect souvenirs from his visits, like stamps in the song. The war tour is also an opportunity for Gypsy Davy as he can strut his stuff, impress the generals and leaders of the war to gain recognition and career advancement. The generals and leaders can be represented by his uncle, who is, of course, Uncle Sam. Was Dylan referring to the Vietnam War? Was Vietnam a concern when Dylan wrote this song? Here is a CBS report in August 1965, made before the release of the Highway 61 Revisited album, which suggests Dylan was probably aware of the horrors of the war.
This is what the war in Vietnam is all about. The old and the very young. The Marines have burned this old couple's cottage because fire was coming from here. Now when you walk into the village, you see no young people at all. Fire was coming from light automatic weapons fire was coming from all of these villages. It's not really one village, it's a string of huts. And the people that are left, come this way, Khan. The people that are left are like this woman here, the very old.
Been in action like this before, Marie?
No, I haven't. Not like this, I haven't.
Did you set fire to these houses here?
No, we were just off to the left of it when it was burning.
Were you getting fire from them?
Somewhat, not too much. Just a little sniper fire.
It first appeared that the Marines had been sniped at and that a few houses were made to pay. Shortly after, an officer told me he had orders to go in and level the string of hamlets that surrounds Cam Ne village. And all around the common paddy field that feeds these hamlets, a ring of fire. 150 homes were leveled in retaliation for a burst of gunfire. In Vietnam, like everywhere else in Asia, property, a home, is everything. A man lives with his family on ancestral land. His parents are buried nearby. Their spirit is part of his holding. If there were Viet Cong in the hamlets, they were long gone. Alerted by the roar of the amphibious tractors and the heavy barrage of rocket fire laid down before the troops moved in. The women and the old men who remained will never forget that August afternoon. The day's operation burned down 150 houses, wounded three women, killed one baby, wounded one Marine, and netted these four prisoners. Four old men who could not answer questions put to them in English. Four old men who had no idea what an ID card was. Today's operation is the frustration of Vietnam in miniature. There is little doubt that American firepower can win a military victory here. But to a Vietnamese peasant whose home is a means a lifetime of backbreaking labor, it will take more than presidential promises to convince him that we are on his side. Morley Safer, CBS News, near the village of Cam Ne.
Well, I have to throw in a political comment. You may see parallels of that Vietnam War with what's going on today in Gaza, and one might be tempted to compare the two. But with the Hamas-Israel war and all the civilian deaths and displacements, however, unlike Hamas, the Viet Cong did not massacre innocent American civilians to start the war. So do not think that I'm comparing the two. Verse 9 offers more allusions to the biblical story of Samson and Delilah. So here's verse 9. The geometry of innocence, flesh on the bone, causes Galileo's math book to get thrown at Delilah, who sits worthlessly alone, but the tears on her cheeks are from laughter. Again, we're getting a sense that we're making a reference to Samson. Why is there a reference to Galileo, first of all, in the first line, and his math book? Galileo di Vincenzo Bentello di Galileo, if I'm pronouncing it right, lived February 1564 to January 8, 1642, and he was a Renaissance man. He was a physicist, a mathematician, an astronomer, and a philosopher. He dared to propose that the earth revolved around the sun. He was tried by the Inquisition, and who of course, took the Bible literally and found vehemently suspected of heresy, and he was forced to recant his claims. He spent the rest of his life under house arrest. So why is his math book being thrown at Delilah? How does that make sense? The play on words, geometry of innocence, flesh on the bone, is the reason for the math book being thrown. Dylan is not referring to the study of geometry by Galileo. Rather, he's likely referring to teenage desire and a young person who gets distracted from his studies by sexual urges, innocence, flesh. So why insert Delilah here? Once again, Dylan is using a well-known mythical or historical person to project a message that is relevant to the time he wrote this, and indeed forever relevant. In biblical times, Delilah, as inferred in the Bible, was a sexual temptress. Samson was raised as a Nazarite, meaning he could not eat grapes, drink wine, or cut his hair. Samson's discipline, however, broke down because of sexual temptations from Delilah, whose tears on her cheeks were from laughter. We know from the Bible story, Delilah got the best out of Samson. Seth Rogaboy, who I read in researching some of the Dylan material that I've compiled, also makes a couple of good insights on this verse. Rogaboy points out that Dylan subtly reintroduces the jawbone indirectly in the verse above with flesh on the bone and tears on her cheek. The cheek is where the flesh covers the jawbone. So indirectly, he is making reference to the jawbone again that he made earlier in the song. Rogaboy also supposes that Dylan is using a pun with the use of the word thrown. Remember, the book is thrown, the math book is thrown at Delilah. And the throne can also be heard as throne, T-H-R-O-N-E, on which the Philistine king sits and where Delilah presumably sits with, worthlessly alone with him. Dylan is not finished yet with allusions to the biblical story of Samson and Delilah. In verse 10, he says, sings, "Now I wish I could give Brother Bill his great thrill. I would set him in chains at the top of the hill, then send out for some pillars and Cecil B. DeMille. He could die happily ever after." Who else but Dylan would use DeMille as a rhyme word in a verse? Note, brother is capitalized, which denotes the fact that the brother, Bill, in the verse, in the first line of the verse, is a religious figure of stature. Maybe Brother Bill is Billy Graham. Dylan is likely mocking another type of authoritarian figure that draws followers. Dylan may be wishing that this religious leader, maybe Billy Graham, should go up in chains to the top of the hill, like Jesus or Samson, and go down as a martyr. Of course, Dylan is describing Samson's fate after he lost the source of his strength and was blinded and humiliated by being forcefully led to a temple on top of the hill in full view of the Philistine noble persons and the king and the queen. Placed as a spectacle for humiliation, leaning against two columnar pillars, which structurally held up the entire temple compound, God granted Samson one last rush of brute strength necessary to push the columns apart, toppling the temple structure and wiping everyone inside, including himself. Samson, at the expense of his own life, got the last laugh. We now understand why, derisively, Dylan asks to send out for some pillars to cast Brother Bill's last stand. Why also send out for Cecil B. DeMille? This is what Wikipedia has to say about DeMille in summary. Cecil Blount DeMille, August 12, 1881, died January 21, 1959, was an American film director, producer, and actor. Between 1914 and 1958, he made 70 features, starting with silent and becoming sound films. He is acknowledged as a founding father of the American cinema and the most commercially successful producer in film history. His films were distinguished by their epic scale and his cinematic showmanship. His first biblical epic, The Ten Commandments, in 1923, a silent version, was both a critical and commercial success. It held the Paramount revenue record for 25 years. One other of his many epic films was, get this, Samson and Delilah, 1949. Now you know why he's conjuring up Cecil B. DeMille. You could say that Dylan was calling out for the pillars DeMille used on his set for the Samson and Delilah film. So let's look at that clip, Samson and Delilah, 1949 Cecil B. DeMille film.
I pray thee, strengthen me, O God. Strengthen me only this once.
What's he doing?
He's holding up the temple.
To his knees beneath the feet of Dagon.
This is better than I had bargained for.
Well, the man's crazed.
Oh, John, he's the funniest clown I've ever seen.
Look! It moved.
The column's moving. We have split the stone.
The man has the strength of a devil.
No, the strength of a god.
My eyes have seen thy glory, O God. Now let me die with my enemies.
Those pillars were obviously very important to Dylan and his image and Samson and Delilah. This is from a Mondo Scripto book that a friend lent to me. It's from a gallery exhibit, and it features 61 Bob Dylan sketches for 61 songs he wrote. This is the sketch for Tombstone Blues, and of course, those are the pillars. Cecil B. DeMille pillars, props, or representing actual pillars. As an aside, the written script for the film comes from the 1930 novel Judges and Fool, also known as Samson the Nazarite, written by none other than the Zionist leader Vladimir Jabotinsky. Jabotinsky was also the spiritual forefather of the Arut Party, which would be led by his dedicated follower, Menachem Begin. Here's verse 11. Where Ma Rainey and Beethoven once unwrapped their bedroll, tuba players now will rehearse around the flagpole, and the National Bank of the Prophet sells roadmaps for the soul to the old folks' home and the college. Ludwig van Beethoven needs no introduction. Born December 17, 1776, died March 26, 1827. But virtually everybody knows he was one of the greatest composers in Western music history. One cannot do justice playing only one small and short sample of Beethoven's incredible musical output, but here's an example to demonstrate how relevant he still is, being a song performed by a relatively well-known, pretty well-known artist in pretty recent times. Here's Alicia Keys performing Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata in honor of Kobe Bryant after he tragically died.
Here on that evening, as well as to the rest of the world. She's here tonight to perform one of Kobe and Vanessa's favorite musical numbers, the immortal Moonlight Sonata by Beethoven. Please welcome Alicia Keys.
Thank you.
I chose that piece not just because it's a short piece and it's a Beethoven piece, but it's also because it's Alicia Keys. She wasn't born when Tombstone Blues was written by Dylan, but decades later, Dylan really liked Alicia Keys. Many decades later, he wrote a song and made a reference to her in the song, and he's admitted he really likes her. You could be forgiven if you then ask, why Ma Rainey is placed by Dylan in the same heralded category as Beethoven. Ma Rainey, born as Gertrude Pridgett, April 26, 1886 to December 22, 1939, lived about as long as Beethoven did, was an influential blues recording artist. She was also an unorthodox artist for her times in that she wrote one-third of the 100 songs she recorded. So she wrote her own songs, which was unusual for the time. And she championed, get this, in the 20s, feminism and lesbianism. Rainey was known for her powerful vocals, energy, phrasing, and unique moaning style of singing. She was called the mother of the blues, gold neck woman of the blues, and paramount wildcat. She was posthumously inducted into the Blues Hall of Fame and later into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. You may even know her as the featured character in the 2020 Netflix Academy Award-winning film, Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, named after a song she herself composed. It was also a Soulpepper Theater stage performance that I saw about a year ago. Can you imagine the following song with its strong lesbianism theme being performed and recorded in 1928? Gertrude Ma Rainey, Groove It on the Blues. So let's listen to her. It's a short song.
When I last night had a great big fight, everything seemed to go wrong. I looked up to my surprise, the gal I was with gone. Where she went, I don't know. I mean to follow everywhere she goes. Folks said I took it, I didn't know where she took it. I want the whole world to know. They say I do it, ain't nobody caught me. You got to prove it on me. Out last night with a crowd of my friends, been muffin' women, cause I don't like no men. It's true, I wear color and a tie, make the wind go all the while. But to say I do it, ain't nobody caught me. They sure got to prove it on me.
First line of the verse where Ma Rainey and Beethoven once unwrapped their bedroll is a bit of a jolt in an absurdist way. The line describes the place where they unwrapped their bedroll. They were obviously sleeping together in the song. Of course, we know Ma Rainey was a lesbian. So another jolt. The bedroll is a sleeping bag or other bedding rolled into a bundle. This would suggest they were musical hobos. This is odd because they never performed in the same time frame or even on the same continents. Dylan has an admiration for hobos, though. Perhaps they are connected because they are both independent-minded, like hobos, and don't live by established rules. Besides, musicians have to travel, like hobos, to earn a living. Both Beethoven and Rainey were iconoclasts in music history, taking music to new frontiers. Dylan is not too impressed by the music and musicians who have entered the music stage to replace him. But I'll just stop for a brief moment. We're almost done. Just got one or two more slides. Dylan, again, is not impressed by music today and musicians who have entered the music stage. They can't replace Ma Rainey or Beethoven. Except for two of the 12 verses, the song narration in this song is in the third person, except for two. In the third-person narration, the narrator exists outside the events of the story and relates the actions of the characters by referring to their names or by the third-person pronouns, he, she, or they. He also describes the society in which we live in a deadpan or matter-of-fact manner. Interestingly, only two of the 12 verses in the song use the first-person narrative with the I perspective. For both verses, using the first person narrative, Dylan opens with, "Now I wish I could." In verse 10, what we already covered, the opening line is, "Now I wish I could give Brother Bill his great thrill." While in verse 12, it is, "Now I wish I could write you a melody so plain." The implication is the song narrator would change the world for better if he could, but implicitly he knows he cannot. Nothing ever changes. The final verse before the last repeat of the chorus goes, "Now I wish I could write you a melody so plain that could hold you, dear lady, from going insane, that could ease you and cool you and cease the pain of your useless and pointless knowledge." The song narrator would change the world if he could, but let's face it, we'll continue to live in an unjust and mixed up world, a world in which there will always be much suffering. Stephen King, the well-known American author of horror, supernatural fiction, suspense, crime, science fiction, and fantasy novels, uses this last verse that we just covered to end his novel, Carrie. King also uses from the uncovered fourth verse, we didn't cover the fourth verse, song verse, the line, "You will not die, it's not poison," in chapter 11 in his novel, Gerald's Game. Clearly, Stephen King thought a lot about this song and Bob Dylan. Using surrealism, jolting our senses about well-known historic or mythical people by making them go through the wrong stage doors, we're made to feel like we are not ever standing on solid ground. The music adds to this effect with its upbeat tempo that feels like it is going too fast and out of control. Mike Bloomfield, who we covered in the last session with Dylan, with his guitar work, takes this song to another level. So we're going to end this session tonight. We're going to let you go through the lyrics and listen to the song, and then we're done.
The sweet pretty things on Bednow, of course. The city fathers they're trying to endorse. The reincarnation of Paul Revere's horse. But the town has no need to be nervous. The ghost of Belle Star, she hands down her wits. To Jezebel and Nun, she violently knits. A bald wig for Jack the Ripper, who sits at the head of the Chamber of Commerce. Mama's in a factory, she ain't got no shoes. Daddy's in the alley, he's looking for food. I'm in the kitchen with the Tombstone Blues. The hysterical bride in the penny arcade. Screaming, she moans, I've just been made. then sends out for the doctor, who pulls down the shade and says, my advice is to not let the boys in. Now the medicine man comes and he shuffles inside. He walks with a swagger and he says to the bride, stop all this weeping, swallow your pride. You will not die, it's not poison. Mama's in a factory, she ain't got no shoes. Daddy's in the alley, he's looking for food. I'm in the kitchen with the tombstone blues. John the Baptist, after torturing a thief, looks up at his hero, the commander-in-chief, saying, tell me, great hero, but please make it brief. Is there a hole for me to get sick in? The commander-in-chief answers him while chasing a fly, saying, death to all those who would whimper and cry. And dropping a barbell, he points to the sky, saying, the sun's not yellow, it's chicken. Mama's in a factory, she ain't got no shoes. Daddy's in the alley, he's looking for food. I am in the kitchen with the tombstone blues. King of the Philistines, his soldiers to save, puts jawbones on their tombstones and flatters their graves, puts the Pied Pipers in prison and fattens the slaves, and sends them out to the jungle. Gypsy Davy with a blowtorch, he burns out their camps. With his faithful slave Pedro behind him, he tramps with a fantastic collection of stamps to win friends and influence his uncle. Mama's in a factory, she ain't got no shoes. Daddy's in the alley, he's looking for food. I'm in trouble with the tombstone blues. Geometry of innocent flesh on the bone causes Galileo's math book to get thrown at Delilah, who's sitting worthlessly alone, but the tears on her cheeks are from laughter. I wish I could give Brother Bill his great thrill. I would set him in chains at the top of the hill, then send out for some pillars and Cecil B. DeMille. He could die happily ever after. Mama's in a factory, she ain't got no shoes. Daddy's in the alley, he's looking for food. I'm in the kitchen with the tombstone blues. Beethoven once unwrapped a bedroll. Tuba players now rehearse around the flagpole. And the national bank at a profit sells roadmaps for the soul to the old folks' home in the college. I wish I could write you a melody so plain that could hold you, dear lady, from going insane. That could ease you and cool you and cease the pain of your useless and pointless knowledge. Mama's in the factory, she ain't got no shoes. Daddy's in the alley, he's looking for food. I'm in the kitchen with the tombstone blues. All right.
Okay, we're done. Another evening is in the books.
Okay. Kol hakavod, Alan. Well done.
Who's that, Steve?
Yeah.
How are you, Steve?
Good, good. Sorry I had to be a little late. We were out with some friends and helping them out. But anyway, it was good. It was really, really good.
Well, you know, the lyrics in his songs on this album are unbelievable. If you like this one, I mean, every song is so impactful.
Incredible, incredible. Great creativity, though. You really showed a lot of interesting insight.
Thank you, Steve. Hey there, there's Hyde. I always like saying hi to Hyde.
How are you?
Very nice to see you, Steve.
Down here in Florida.
Hey, keeping warm, I hope. We're
no,
pretty
no,
cold.
It's terrible,
here.
But you know, it'll get better.
Yeah, okay. We were in Florida last week with my good buddy Jimmy, and the weather wasn't great, but it was good enough, and we had a good time. We made the best of it.
Right. I hope to see you soon.
Yeah, I hope so too. And there,
anyway, it was a great session. That was, as they said, you know, lyrics fantastic.
Thank you so much. I love doing his stuff, but I think that people are getting a little Dylan fatigued, but he offers so much in every song he writes, and this particularly in this album and the next. They're really unbelievable lyrics. So thank you. There's some familiar names here. Barbara, there's my minion mate. My son Ari's here. And of course, got to mention Alexa, who was very busy, but showed up to help me with Sanchia, couldn't make it, and mentioned earlier at the beginning of the session, she does these great sessions every week, Wednesday night at 6:30, called Holy History. She's got a great following. She's been doing it for years, and you're welcome to join us at Beth Sholom. And I don't know if Alexa would like to add anything to that, but...
Thank you so much, Alan. Thanks for plugging Holy History. I really appreciate it. And I really, really enjoyed tonight. I'm happy to come back anytime. It was really, I was watching here with my husband and we loved it. Very entertaining. So thank you, Alan. Thanks for all the hard work that goes into these sessions.
Well, that means a lot to me because it comes from you.
Oh, that's very sweet. No, I really enjoyed it. Just a reminder to everyone, you can always see what's coming up at Beth Sholom just at www.bethsholom.net. We always have a what's coming soon section, upcoming events, and you can take a look at Alan's upcoming programs, my upcoming programs, whatever we have coming down the pipeline, you can take a look at. It's available for everyone and you can register right there. But
yeah,
thanks for coming out tonight.
Probably doing Cohen. Again, in search of Hollywood, in search of Cohen himself. As you know, he came back to life and became very popular in mid-70s. So it's a great story, and we can do that probably over three sessions.
Amazing. I'm sure everyone's looking forward. Thanks, Alan. Does anyone have any final questions? I can facilitate any questions. Does anyone have any questions, comments? Looks like everyone's good. Thanks, everybody, for logging in. We'll see everybody very soon at an upcoming program. And thank you again,
thank
Alan.
You, everybody. Good night.
Have a good night.
Thank you, Alan.
Thank you for